Welcome back to the fourth day of the world's first virtual implant expo. My name is Ruben Lobo, and on behalf of Team DentistChannel.online, I warmly invite everyone who's watching us live from various parts of the globe. I hope you all have been doing well and you're keeping safe in these unprecedented times of the COVID-19 pandemic. This was one of the reasons, rather the main reason, why we thought of having a virtual implant expo. This is your chance to connect with stalwarts, pioneers, master dental technicians and implantologists and prolific speakers like our next speaker, Dr. Ankita Jain, to connect with them and to learn from the best. Ladies and gentlemen, without much further delay, I would like to invite and welcome our speaker for this session, Dr. Ankita Jain. A short introduction about a speaker. She completed her BDS in the year 2012 and her MDS in the year 2017. She topped the university postgraduate examinations. Currently, she's working as a full-time clinician in a reputed multi-specialty dental hospital. She's also heading a project as a principal investigator, which is approved by the Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, titled as the Development of Community-Based Tobacco Cessation Program in Lucknow and Kanpur regions of India. She has completed a project as a co-investigator which dealt with corticotomy-facilitated orthodontic treatment. She's a part of an NGO which is called as a Joint Association of the Academic System of Human Welfare Society. She's published several papers in various journals of international and national repute. She's also presented papers and posters in various state, national and international conferences and conventions. She has to credit several awards and recognitions for the kind of research work she's doing for the betterment of the society. Ladies and gentlemen, presenting to you, Dr. Ankita Jain Live.
Thank you so much, Ruben, for such a pleasant introduction, and good afternoon, all of you. So my topic for today's lecture is significance of biomarkers in the peri-implant cellular fluid. Before beginning with the topic, I would like to extend my thanks to the DentistChannel.online for providing me this platform to speak myself on this topic. And especially, I would like to thank Mr. Melvin for the same. We have got very little time frame to complete this topic. So let's rush up with the contents. There would be an introduction, conventional methods and limitations which are used for the diagnosis till now for peri-implantitis, a slight comparative analysis of GCF and PISF. Then I'll take you in the lanes of the evidences which are present in the literature. There would be chair. We will then discuss about the presently what all chairside kits are present for evaluation of biomolecules in the peri-implant cellular fluid. Then we will talk about the future potentials. Definitely this topic is actually in its infancy stage. It has got a lot of potential in the research right now so that we can hopefully use it in our day-to-day practice. Next conclusion, and then I'll wrap up with the references. First of all, introduction. So the data actually was taken up from the United States because very less studies on the prevalence of dental implants has been done in the Asian countries. So I've just taken this data from United States just for an idea. So it has been seen that 14% implant prevalence was there from when they have evaluated from 1999 to 2016. And if the implant placement will take place at this pace, then definitely it would increase up to 17% by 2026. So whenever the procedures comes in, at this pace, the procedure is used in our day-to-day practice, then dentists tend to face the challenges, complications related to that procedures, right? So for knowing the complications, for predicting the severity of diseases, we should have some diagnostic tools. So before discussing the diagnostic tools, we will see some of the about the terminologies like peri-implant mucositis and peri-implantitis. What is peri-implant mucositis? Basically, it is the lesion of the soft tissue surrounding an endosseous implant without loss of supporting bone. Okay, and but there would be continuous marginal bone loss. Okay, and the clinically it would represent something like this. The bleeding on probing would be there, and there would be suppuration and rolled off gingiva. In short, we'll take peri-implantitis. When the peri-implant mucositis is not prevented or treated, then it can lead to the peri-implantitis. And according to the WWP World Workshop Periodontology 2017, by definition, it is defined as a pathological condition occurring in the tissues around dental implants, characterized by the inflammation in the peri-implant connective tissue, and there would be progressive bone loss. Okay. And clinically, if you will see, then there will be deep periodontal pocket depth. There would be bone loss more than 3 mm and pocket depth measuring more than 6 mm, along with the bleeding on probing and suppuration. Okay. Now, in order to diagnose the peri-implantitis and peri-implant mucositis, we have certain tools which are very easy to use and which are used very frequently and in our day-to-day practice. Those are clinical methods and the radiographical methods. Let's take them one by one. In clinical method, we have periodontal probes through which we measure the pocket depth, clinical attachment loss, mobility, bleeding on probing. Very much we can do. But there are certain limitations with this method. We'll discuss it in our later slide. These are clinical parameters which we see and detect the peri-implantitis or peri-implant mucositis. Next method is radiological method. Radiological method are used as an adjunct to clinical methods basically. In the radiological method, basically we see the level of bone and the bone loss in the consecutive appointments or consecutive visit of the patients. So, if the bone loss is more than 3 mm, then it is considered to be the peri-implantitis case. Now, the main problem is with the radiograph is the dentist has to take care that radiograph should be standardized. At every visit, it should be taken at a particular angulation and the position of the patient so that two radiographs can be compared easily. Okay. So, there are certain limitations to these conventional methods of detecting the peri-implantitis and peri-implant mucositis. What are these? First of all, it is a laborious diagnostic procedure. Okay? Because every time the patient visit to you, you have to have the record of it. Okay? You have to record it with a similar kind of pressure of the probe, at similar angulation of the probe. There should be some expertise in using the radiological and clinical methods. Okay, so this is one of the major big drawback. Other drawback is it has got low sensitivity and low predictive value. So reliable information cannot be obtained by these methods. Expertise is needed, as I said, the episodic progression of periodontitis and peri-implantitis. That means episodic progression means we all know that both the disease entities basically run with the dormant phase and an active phase. Okay, so it makes little complex to predict the severity of the disease and to provide the treatment plan for such patients with the help of these methods. Current disease activity cannot be assessed. Yes, already the disease has initiated and disease has taken place, damage has been done. Whether it is reversible or irreversible, it only after the damage we come to know that yes, the peri-implantitis is going on. In advance, we are not able to predict about the disease, about the progression of the disease. Future progression and severity cannot be predicted. Sometimes irreversible damage in the form of more bone loss, greater bone loss occurs, which is difficult to regenerate. And in such cases, even grafts cannot regenerate the bone up to the same level which was initially present. Clinical measurements around implants again is a great challenge because it is affected by implant geometry, prosthetic design, and peri-implant soft tissue biotype. So it is more difficult than that of natural tooth. Now, if these are the limitations of these very convenient and the popular diagnostic modalities, then what is the next step or what is the next thing we can look for to predict and determine the disease severity or disease progression in advance. Then comes the role of biomarker. Here the biomarkers actually what is biomarker? Biomarker is basically a parameter which objectively measured and evaluate as an indicator of normal biological, that means in health also these biomolecules will be present, pathogenic process. If any kind of pathology is present in the peri-implant tissues, then these biomolecules range or concentration will get fluctuate, or responses to the therapeutic intervention. That means before treatment and after treatment, the concentration of these biomolecules tends to get changed. So that is how with the fluctuations, with the changes, with the shift of concentration and the quantity of these biomolecules, we can actually predict the diseases well advanced of clinical and radiological manifestations. Recently, in the World Workshop 2017, a new updated classification of periodontal diseases was given, okay, in which it was suggested that validated biomarkers in the case definition system should be incorporated. But since we don't have much evidences now for the biomolecules, we cannot grade the severity of peri-implantitis or periodontitis on the basis of the presence and absence of these biomolecules. But it is expected, we hope that in the next updated classification, we will have biomarkers as one of the criteria to define the periodontal diseases. Now, biomarkers usually in case of implant, we will restrict our discussion up to the peri-implant sulcular fluid. Other sources are saliva and gingival crevicular fluid. What are the advantages we are going to get by biomarkers, basically? So, biomarkers advantages, they help in diagnosing, screening, monitoring, and prevention of the periodontal and peri-implant diseases. So, it is all clear, I guess. It assists in staging and grading of periodontitis, and it can inhibit or reduce the conversion of gingivitis into periodontitis and peri-implant mucositis into the peri-implantitis. Okay, we can prevent the conversion of the initial stages of the diseases into the advanced stages of the diseases. Now, how to collect this fluid? This fluid is collected with PISF, peri-implant sulcular fluid. This fluid is basically present between the gingiva and the implants. Okay, similar to that of GCF. Now, paper strips is the most common method to be used for the PISF collection. It is inserted into the sulcus, into the crevice for 30 seconds. It is left over there for 30 seconds. Then it is the PISF gets absorbed onto the paper strips. Then these paper strips are transferred into the fluid in which the biomarker analysis is done. Okay. And commercially, PerioPaper, PerioPol, these are present, these are the brand names under which these paper strips are there for the collection of PISF. Other methods are paper cones, membranes, microcapillary pipettes, as you can see in the figure. So these are actually other methods, but in 80% cases, paper strips are used. Next is enzyme-linked analysis of the fluid. Yes, once the PISF, the fluid is collected, now how to analyze the biomolecules in them? So most in 80 to 85% of cases, ELISA is used. This method is used in most of the studies. Next is flow cytometry, Luminex, spectrophotometry, radioimmunoassay. These are the other methods in which which have been used in different studies. But enzyme-linked immunosorbent assay is basically used in majority of the studies. Now, when we compare the GCF and PISF, so more or less they are similar in their formation as well as their response towards the clinical inflammation. But there are slight differences. Like in inflammation, GCF increases, GCF secretion is more. If in an individual, there is same grade of inflammation around the natural tooth and around the implant, then there will be more secretion of the GCF in case of natural tooth as compared to PIS. Sites, it is little bit controversy. Different studies have given different kind of observations. Clinical indices and volume. Yes, volume of the GCF increases with the clinical parameters like increased probing depth, clinical attachment loss, etc. But this is more related. I mean, if the clinical parameters are kept constant, then the response of GCF quantitatively is more as compared to PISF. So if we overall the studies have concluded that GCF and PISF volume show similar nature and pattern through increasing rates of inflammation, but PISF shows better correlation with the clinical indices, better correlation with the clinical parameters. Next, now we will, for next 10 to 15 minutes, we will roam in the lanes of the evidences which are present in relation to the biomarkers which are being studied continuously in the PISF so that they can be used as a promising tool in our day-to-day clinical practice. Now, there are cytokines, chemokines, bone metabolism markers, enzymes, and other PISF components. Now, all these biomolecules are now under research, but we'll take just important ones like DNF alpha and interleukin 1 beta, interleukin 10. Then in chemokines, we will study interleukin 8. In bone metabolism markers, all the three are very important. All the three have been studied in various studies. Enzymes, MMPs, they are the most important one, out of which MMP8 is considered to be the most promising tool. And MPO we will take in detail little. And then other PISF components are also there, which are under study, but only one or two studies have been done on rest of the biomolecules. Now let's see the evidences I have categorized into pro-inflammatory cytokines, anti-inflammatory bone loss markers and enzymes. Let's see one by one the details about the most significant biomolecules. Under pro-inflammatory cytokines, first of all, we will take interleukin 1 beta. Now, we all know that interleukin 1 beta is basically an inflammatory cytokine which is secreted by the activated macrophages, monocytes, lymphocytes, fibroblasts, vascular cells, these cells, right? Then, these interleukin 1 beta mainly cause the proliferation of fibroblasts and endothelial cells, which leads to the inflammation. Again, they also increases the synthesis of collagenase enzymes, which leads to the degradation of the periodontal ligament during the inflammation. It regulates the degradation of the extracellular matrix components also, and it has the collagenase activity during the inflammation and wound healing. So it is mainly towards destructive responses. It causes degradation of the PDL. Various studies have been seen. Various studies have been done, like Cao et al. In 95 has done a cross-sectional study, and they have considered 90 subjects in their study. They have reported that they have seen elevated levels of this biomolecule, that is interleukin 1 beta, and it was 3 times in the diseased implant compared to the healthy ones. Similar case study was done on the interleukin 1 beta by the Panagopoulos and co-workers. They have also observed that greater levels of inflammatory cytokines. They have studied the group of cytokines, and all of the inflammatory cytokines were found to be more in case of peri-implantitis group. Aniruddha Kajale and team has done a cross-sectional studies. They also indicated that the biomolecule increases significantly in the peri-implantitis cases, and they increases with the clinical and radiographical. They increases along with the clinical parameters and the radiographical parameters. and they can be used as an adjunct. They suggested it should be used as an adjunct to for the assessment of peri-implantitis. Gassip et al. Recently in 2019 has done a systematic review in which he has studied the till date articles, and they have suggested and observed that interleukin 1 and 6 basically increases significantly in the peri-implant diseases condition. Mostly they are more in peri-implantitis condition than the peri-implant mucositis conditions, and of course they are more than the PISF in the health of healthy implants. Next is tumor necrosis factor alpha. Tumor necrosis factor alpha is basically a multi-effect cytokine that has many functions, right from the cell migration to the cell destruction. Okay, this is the first biomolecule which is presented to the antigen after recognition and presentation of the microbes. Okay, it is mainly secreted by the monocytes and macrophages. It also induces the secretion of collagenase by the fibroblasts. It destructs the periodontal tissue. It causes apoptosis of fibroblasts, which is the major cell for the secretion of the collagen and collagenases. It activates the osteoclast. That means its presence will result in the bone resorption and the cartilage resorption. Next, we come on to the studies which have been done on TNF-alpha. So, Fett and team in 2015 did a systematic review and meta-analysis in which they have considered the articles from 1993 to 2013. Okay, they have accumulated, they have collected all the articles between this period, and they have observed that statistical differences were there when TNF levels were compared between the healthy implants and the peri-implant diseases. But they have suggested that there were no significant difference in the molecules between peri-implant mucositis sites and peri-implantitis sites. Next is Zemi, SR, and team in 2016 performed a cross-sectional study. They suggested that biomarkers can help to discriminate between the healthy and the diseased sites. And they have studied 20 biomarkers, out of which 12 biomarkers they have found to be significant. Next, we come on to the Gassip et al. In 2019, in the similar study, that of interleukin 1 beta, in the same study, they have also observed the effect of TNF-alpha, and they have found higher levels of TNF-alpha in the diseased compared to the healthy implants. Next are chemokines. Chemokines and cytokines, both are basically the messenger cells. Okay, messenger cells, they secrete from one cell and convey the message to the other cell and induce activation of those cells. Okay, sources of these chemokines are basically lipopolysaccharide activated macrophages, endothelium, J cells, monocyte, fibroblast, and lymphocytes. Functions, these are potent chemotactic factor for the leukocytes. Very important, interleukin 8 is the first cytokine which was discovered as a chemoattractant. That means at a low concentration, interleukin 8 attracts the neutrophils and causes their extravasation, whereas at higher concentration, it activates the neutrophils and causes the secretion of the defense granules from the neutrophils. Okay, so it has major chemotactic effect on neutrophil. It has got direct action on the osteoclast differentiation. So that means if it induces the osteoclast differentiation, definitely it will lead to the bone resorption. We have got major, there are several kind of interleukins also, but we have major interest in interleukin 8 because it has got a major role in the pathogenesis of the periodontitis as well as peri-implantitis. Next, we come on to the literature provided about this interleukin 8. So, Patwick and team in 2010 did cross-sectional study in which they have used filter paper technique for the collection of the PISF. And they have found that healthy group has lower concentration of the interleukin 8, whereas there is more concentration in case of diseased group. Liu et al. In 2011 again did a cross-sectional study. Renvert also did a cross-sectional study. Both of them are in the favor that diseased sites have higher concentration of interleukin 8 as compared to the healthy sites. But when we compare peri-implant mucositis sites and peri-implantitis sites, then some of the studies are in favor that more concentration is at peri-implantitis site, whereas some studies are in the favor that there is no significant difference between both the diseased antibodies. Now, in anti-inflammatory, under anti-inflammatory cytokines, we will study interleukin 10. It has got a major role in suppressing the immune responses by inhibiting the antigen-presenting capacity of macrophages. The sources are mainly B cell, mast cell, eosinophils, macrophages, dendritic cell, subset of T cells such as CD8 plus T cells, etc. Their function is to suppress the immunity, suppress the immune cells basically, which causes inflammation. That means they have reverse effect. They are good cytokines. They have reverse effect and they promote the regeneration of the periodontium. They promote osteoblastic differentiation and they suppresses osteoclastic differentiation. So the literature, only two or three, like 5 to 6 studies have been done. I've mentioned two of them. They have done cross-sectional studies and they found Cassidou et al. He has actually considered 30 samples, and out of which interleukin levels were found to be higher in the healthy group as compared to the diseased group. Whereas Atta, Ali, and team in 2015 performed cross-sectional study again, and they found that interleukin 10 was significantly higher in the diseased sites as compared to the healthy peri-implant sites. So both of them have got opposite results. One has got interleukin 10 levels high in the healthy sites and one has got high in the diseased sites. So it is said that interleukin 10 could be possibly present at higher level in the diseased sites because it also regulates the cellular and humoral immune system. It basically acts as a B cell later and it causes its proliferation and inflammation. Okay, so it regulates the cellular and humoral immune responses. So that's why it is quite possible in order to initiate these responses as a part of defense mechanism, these interleukin 10 was found to be significantly higher at diseased site also. Now these are very important bone loss markers. Bone loss markers, first of all, we should understand what is Rankl and OPG. Rankl is basically, these are the membrane-bound ligand which are expressed onto the cell membrane. Okay, these are membrane-bound, cell membrane, in cell membrane they are present. These cells are osteoblast, fibroblast, bone marrow stromal cell, and activated T-cell, B-cell. So, for example, here, this ligand is denoted as rank and it is present onto the cell membrane of this cell. This is a cell like osteoblast and Rankl is present over the cell membrane of this cell. Then there is something called rank. Rank is receptor on the surface of osteoclast. Now there is an inactive osteoclast is there on which this receptor is present. When the Rank and Rankl interaction takes place, then this pre-osteoclast gets differentiated and convert into osteoclast, which further results in the resorption of bone. So in order to prevent this interaction and prevent the conversion of pre-osteoclast into osteoclast, there is something called OPG. These OPG are the decoy receptor of Rank, which will block the Rankl and prevent the bond between the or prevent the interaction between the Rankl and Rank. Okay, and so that osteoclast don't differentiate into active osteoclast and don't lead to the bone resorption. So it is something, these three molecules have something to do this with in such a way they regulate the bone metabolism. Okay. Now, the studies have been done in relation to these molecules also. So, Monov, in 2006, they did a pilot study of around 13 implants. They have collected PISF and studied the clinical outcomes also. Along with, in all their studies, in most of their studies, along with the biomarkers, they have recorded the clinical and the radiographical parameters also. And then they have related the same. So they saw that there is no correlation between the markers and the clinical outcomes. Arikan and team did cross-sectional study and published their study in 2008, in which they have seen that OPG in 79% of the PICF samples, and they show significant positive relation with the bleeding on probing. Means bleeding on probing increased, OPG also increased in response to increase in RANK. But S-Rankle is soluble Rankle, it was detected only in 12% of PICF samples. Rankic in 2013, their team also did a case control study and they found significantly higher levels of soluble Rankle, OPG and RANK in peri-implantitis site compared to the healthy implant sites. Of course, if the bone resorption will be more in peri-implantitis, these molecules tend to increase in those particular sites. Enzymes. Now we come on to the enzymes. Enzyme cathepsin. Now cathepsin are basically the proteases. Okay, these are the proteases which are secreted by the lysosomes and in the active form. These are formed in the Golgi apparatus and then secreted in the lysosome, where in the inactive form, and lysosomes secrete them in the activated form. There are three categories of cathepsin, but we are more interested in the cathepsin K, which is cysteine proteases. Okay, and these are expressed predominantly in the osteoclast. That's why we are restricting our study only up to the cathepsin K for now. They selectively express in the active resorbing osteoclast. Their function is, again, it has a catabolic action on the extracellular bone matrix. It breaks down the bone and cartilage. These are localized in the odontoclast in case of deciduous teeth when the physiologic resorption takes place, physiologic root resorption takes place, then these cathepsin K have got a role to resorb the bone. Okay. And these are the known marker of the bone turnover. So it has, this enzyme has been extensively studied and it has been found that more the bone resorption, more the bone turnover, cathepsin, the concentration of cathepsin enzymes will be found more in that particular site. Authors who have studied this cathepsin K, they have did pilot study, and Gamelic et al. They have done cross-sectional study basically, and they both of them have suggested that cathepsin K can be used as a biological parameter for monitoring the alveolar bone loss around the implant sites. Hall and team in 2015 did a controlled case cross-sectional study. They didn't find any kind of significant difference between the healthy sites and the peri-implantitis site in terms of cathepsin K. And they found one other finding was there. They have studied group of enzymes. I have just considered here about the cathepsin K, but they have studied so many enzymes together. And when they have observed cathepsin K, so there were no significant difference. But TPA, we will talk about it in our later slide. This enzyme was found to be elevated in the diseased site compared to the healthy site, and they found that it could be a strong predictor of marginal bone loss in their study basically. Now, MMP8, it's a very important enzyme as far as periodontitis and peri-implantitis is considered. It is an endopeptidase enzyme. Six categories are there of MMP. Matrix metalloproteinases have six categories on the basis of their substrate specificity. Structurally, all the MMPs are similar in structure. Structurally, all are similar, but they have got a specific substrate specificity towards their substrate. Okay, and since based on the biochemical and immunological findings, MMP-8 has found to be a promising diagnostic tool in case of GCF also and in case of saliva also. Now it's turn of PISF whether MMP-8 is a promising tool here or not. Main sources of MMP-8 are gingiva, PDL fibroblast, neutrophils, macrophages, epithelial cells, interleukin-1 and TNF-alpha or TNF. Functions, they cleave the collagen basically and degrade the extracellular matrix. They also modifies the cytokine actions and activates the osteoclast. So basically, they cause destruction of the periodontal ligament. They are normally in healthy condition. They are inhibited by various inhibitors like TIMP, MMP1, etc. But if they are in action, then they will cause the destruction of periodontium. Many authors have proposed good studies and have evaluated MMP-8 with a good study design, like Bazigmes et al. Has done a longitudinal study in which they have collected the sample at 6th, 12th and 18th month. And they have also recorded the clinical and radiographical parameters on this month at these intervals. Okay, they have given a very good finding that probing depth, they found that probing depth was increased at 12th month. Okay, on the contrary, MMP-8 level demonstrated higher values at the 6th month only. That means MMP-8 levels have signaled that probing depth is going to increase in the future. So they have suggested MMP-8 promises to be an early signal of peri-implant inflammation. MMP-8 levels have actually given them the signal that after 6 months or so, or in near future, the clinical parameters going to get affected due to the periodontitis, because MMP-8 are considered to be the initial sign of considered as a sign of initiation of the pathology. Ramisir in 2016 have proposed the findings of 10 years retrospective study, and they have found a positive correlation between the MMP-8 probing depth and bleeding on probing on both GCF and PISF. Higher levels are associated with the inflammation around teeth and implant, while lower levels of MMP-1 and TIMP-1, these are MMP-8 inhibitors. So they have got, their levels have got decreased, and in case of a peri-implantitis around the implants. Okay. So these all findings suggest that MMP-8 is a very promising molecule and can prove to be an effective diagnostic tool in coming future. There are two more studies. They have shared their findings in the form of cross-sectional study. Collagenase 2, again, and collagenase 3, MMP-8 is a collagenase 2. These were higher in the groups which have more than 3 mm of bone loss than in the other groups which have less than 3 mm of bone loss. Similar kind of finding they have given in their next study also. And MMP-8, they have suggested that it is a promising biomarker for peri-implant osteolysis. Now, there are certain suggested reasons for MMP upregulation, that why this biomolecule specifically gets affected during the inflammation or during the initiation of the pathogenesis of periodontitis. So first reason is there is polymorphism in the promoter region of MMP-8. This explains their varied responses between different individuals with the same disease category. Okay. Interleukin-1 and TNF, these are the cytokines which are the first one to get secreted when there is attack of pathogen. And they induce the secretion of MMP-8, which in turn cleaves the helix of collagen and collectively degrades the PCM. Similar to periodontitis, we all know that periodontitis and peri-implantitis more or less follow the same pattern of pathogenesis. So we have got a good amount of literature, a moderate amount of literature showing that MMP8 levels are high in case of periodontitis than healthy sites. So we can expect a similar case in the peri-implantitis also. We can expect that MMP8 can be a molecule which increases at in a very initial stage when there is subclinical inflammation only, then only these MMP8 levels can give us a signal that in future the periodontitis can occur or peri-implantitis can occur. Thus various researchers from all over the world has shown their reliability on MMP8 as a promising diagnostic tool to investigate well advanced about the peri-implant inflammation. Next is myeloperoxidase enzyme. Now, myeloperoxidase enzymes are antimicrobial derived from leukocyte, and they are found in very high concentration in the azerophilic granules of neutrophils. Okay. Since neutrophils are the first line of defense cells, so if the number of neutrophil increases, then the MPO will automatically increase. So if in any pathologic condition or if any condition MPO level is found to be increased, then it is a signal that there is some kind of inflammation going on in the periodontal tissue. Their function is to produce hypochlorous acid. Basically, they help the neutrophil. It is one of the mechanisms of the neutrophil to show their defense action towards the pathogen. They produce hydrochlorous acid, which gets dissociated into hydrogen peroxide and chloride ions, which kills bacteria and pathogens. And there is second mechanism through which they work. They oxidize tyrosine to tyrosyl radicals, which are again cytotoxic to kill bacteria and pathogens. Two studies have been done till date for the MPO, and they have shared the finding that amount of MPO was significantly higher in the PISF, which are collected from the peri-implantitis sites. Other biomolecules, now those we have taken in detail. Now these are the biomolecules, only one study I have picked up, and very less studies have been done on these basically. So these are AST. AST is basically a cross-sectional study is done over AST. It is a cytoplasmic enzyme which is present intracellularly, and it increases when the cell death occurs. Okay, so more the amount of AST, that means more cell death is taking place, and it has shown significant association with the positive bleeding on probing, increased probing depth, and increased gingival index. Darabi et al. Has studied interleukin 17. Recently, in recent few years, interleukin 70 has got significant importance in terms of pathogenesis of periodontitis. And they have done a cross-sectional study, and they found that periodontitis groups had higher interleukin 17 concentration. Murata et al. In 2002, they have studied osteocalcin. Osteocalcin levels were found to be higher in the PICF. Osteocalcin is basically the calcium binding protein of bone, and it is found mostly in the non-collagenous part of the bone matrix. Wang et al. Has detected VEGF, that is vascular endothelial growth factor, in a cross-sectional study. At the diseased site, they were significantly high. Basically, the presence of VEGF basically shows that there is increased capillary permeability, increased endothelial cells. They stimulate the migration of monocytes, induces proteolytic enzyme secretion. So the presence of VEGF actually tells that the inflammation is going on.
Please wind up your presentation, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. There are a few more. TPA, elastase, PGE2, these all shows the inflammation, these all are related to inflammation and found to be high in the inflammatory areas. There were some interventional studies done in which treatment was done preoperatively the biomolecules were evaluated, then intervention was given, and postoperatively those biomolecules were found to be significantly either reduced or there were no significant differences for the same. Like for example, in this study, OPG Rankine ratio was found to be significantly reduced 3 months post therapy. Here, PGE to interleukin 8 was an oral hygiene measure for 3 months was given, but no statistical difference was found in terms of biomolecules. Similarly, these are few more studies in which in some of the studies, significant reduction of the biomolecules were found after the intervention. Next, we come on to, this is the most important part because it is of clinical significance. Chairside diagnostic test was established so that we can evaluate the biomolecules in front of the patient there, then and there, motivate him and provide treatment when he needs it. Ditzer et al. Has in 2017 they have given a chewing gum in which MMP-8 detection is done by the patient itself. Patient will feel bitterness in their taste if MMP-8 levels were found to be elevated. They have created a molecule in which a bitter substance was attached. In between there was a sensor peptide, and in the last there was a microparticle. So if MMP-8 molecules were elevated, then MMP-8 enzymes are elevated in the oral fluids, then they will cleave this bond and these parts will become free. This is basically bitter substance, which is also known as denatonium. Denatonium is the most bitter substance found till date on this planet. So even the slight concentration of this substance is present in the patient's mouth, he will feel bitter, and we can predict that yes, some amount of MMP-8 levels are present over there. But the disadvantage of this was, limitation of this chewing gum test was that, firstly, this bond can be cleaved by other enzymes also, like MMP-1, MMP-9, etc. Secondly, no validity was given, no specificity, no sensitivity of the test was given by the authors. So these are some of the limitations of this particular chewing gum test. And thirdly, it is not a site specific. Anywhere in the mouth, if the inflammation is there, it will straightway give the bitter taste. Next is implant safe. This is the most reliable test kit present till date. It was discovered in Finland. It also detects the elevated level of MMP. If the MMP levels are greater than 220 nanogram per ml, then it can be detected easily by this test. There are two things, that is PerioSafe and implant safe. PerioSafe detects the MMP-8 levels in the oral fluid. So it is patient specific. It can be used by patient also. And implant safe, it is site specific. It evaluates the MMP-8 levels in the GCF as well as in the PISF. And quantitative analysis also can be done of MMP-8 with the help of oral lyzer after collecting the PISF onto the stick. These oral lyzer act as a reader, and within 5 minutes, it will give you the quantity of MMP-8 present in that particular amount. Advantages of this is it differentiates active from inactive periodontal and peri-implant site easily. It is quick and inexpensive. It has got high sensitivity and specificity, that is 90% sensitivity and 70-85% specificity. Can identify initial and alarm, and we can prevent the pre-periodontitis stage from getting converted into periodontitis stage. The test is positive ahead, before the clinical manifestations actually are visible. And latest, just 15 days back only, one article is published on this, which has given its a positive validity about this test. Limitations of studies till date are, there are so many differences in study design, material and methods. Radiographical definitions of peri-implantitis are different are considered different and followed differently by different authors. Some have considered greater than 4 mm bone loss. Some have considered greater than 3 mm bone loss in case of periodontitis. So there are different categories which they have followed. So the information is not reliable. Then if we consider 2017 World Workshop, in which they have mentioned clearly that more than 3 mm of bone loss will be considered as peri-implantitis, then most of the studies most of the studies have taken wrong categorization of the peri-implant mucositis and peri-implant titis. Then they have considered only few cytokines, enzymes or pathogens, and there is no mention of sensitivity and specificity about their studies. They have not considered the other factors like smoking habits, systemic co-founders like diabetes and related criteria. They have the technique, the paper strip, cones, membranes, these devices, if they have to be used, they need expertise. So we can't rely on the information about the collection of the fluid. Biomarker concentration in the collected PI cells may be adjusted for the collected volume due to high volume in inflamed tissue. So no reliable information is provided here also. This is very important, that cyclic progression of peri-implant diseases may affect the various immunoinflammatory events of biomarkers. This means that most of these studies are cross-sectional studies, and it is possible that the sample is taken in the cross-sectional studies. Basically, the sample is taken only once at a particular point of time. So it is possible that the sample is collected in the dormant phase, then it will give wrong result. Even if the disease is progressing, it will give wrong result, because it might possible that at the time of a sample collection, the patient is in its dormant stage of disease. So that's why more longitudinal studies are required, so that we can study the shift of biomarkers and preoperative to postoperative. Then there are certain future potentials. Definitely, this, again I am repeating that this topic is in its very initial stage. Only in last decade some studies have come up with good results. Otherwise, more amount of evidences and researches should be done there. Metabolomics is one of the things, like it is a study of the molecules, a set of molecules in a cell, tissue or organism. So proteome analysis of GCF has been studied so far very much extensively, but for PISF it has not been studied. So we should study, so that in health and disease, we should study the complete set of proteins, complete set of biomolecules, so that we can differentiate between the two by just evaluating the biomolecules in the healthy state and in the diseased state. Next is genotype and phenotype. Here also the literature is very scarce and very is not sufficient to comment on it. It has been suggested by some of the studies that particular genotype and phenotype are susceptible to the periodontitis and maybe to the peri-implantitis also. So this has also got a good scope of good potential to be researched upon, so that we can know that particular phenotype and genotype are susceptible and we can think up for them something else. Okay, there are few studies which have seen in certain population that 12 polymorphism could be related to the biological complications in the implantology, but this has not proven yet. So these can be taken into consideration for further research. So I conclude by saying that though conventional methods like clinical and radiographical methods are easy to use, but they cannot predict the disease progression, the initiation of the disease, the future of the disease. They cannot give the current disease status. So we need something like biomolecules which can tell us in well advance that yes, your procedure is going to get affected in the coming future. So give the treatment right now in the patient, take some action right now for the patient. So I hope that like MMP8 has shown some positiveness with this positiveness in this field. I hope some of more molecules would be taken up in the future, and the results, we should try to evaluate multi biomolecules, I mean many biomolecules in combination, so that we can have more valid results. These are my references. You can contact me. And yeah, today I would like to introduce with my channel also Your Dental Tutor. It's on YouTube. Load the videos in which notes are shared and are given in a very charts, diagrams, line diagrams, so that you can easily reproduce them in your examinations. So if you are looking something for something like this, then you can surely watch them out. I would love to know the feedback about this lecture as well as videos uploaded on the.
Thank you, Dr. Angita.